Hey guys, I'm Venkat and this is part 8 of web development with Blazor. In this video, we'll discuss how to perform paging in Blazor DataGrid. Let's quickly take a tour of what we want to implement in this video. Take a look at the bottom of the grid here. We have 34 rows in total and we are looking at the first page of 7 available pages. We see 5 rows on the page here. Why? Well, because that's what we have selected from the drop-down list right here. If I change this to 10, we see 10 rows. If I select 5, we see the 5 rows again. In the pager, at the bottom here, we are displaying 3 pages, 1, 2, and 3. If I want to see the next set of 3 pages, I click on these 3 dots. At the moment, we are displaying 3 pages. Can I change this to 5 pages? Absolutely. DataGrid is highly customizable. The support for paging is provided out of the box by Syncfusion DataGrid component. It's very powerful and offers several features like adaptive UI, touch support, globalization and localization, export to Excel, PDF and CSV. Sorting, paging, filtering, grouping supports all the CRUD operations, aggregated column values and many more. You'll be amazed by the power and functionality the DataGrid component brings to your Blazor app. Saves so much of our development time and effort. It's very easy to integrate, configure, and use. Another good news is Syncfusion components are free if you are an individual or a company and meet the following two conditions: less than $1 million in annual gross revenue and 5 or fewer developers. The following is the link to claim the free community license, which is what I am using as well. Now, we discussed how to add and configure Syncfusion DataGrid component in part 4 of this video series. I'll include the link both to the video and the playlist in the description box below this video. Let's quickly go over the steps. Step 1. Install syncfusion.blazor.grid NuGet package. Step 2. For styling, reference Syncfusion Bootstrap theme file in index.html file. In a Blazor WebAssembly project, you will find index.html file in www root folder. Step 3, in imports.razor file, include these two using declarations. Step 4, register Syncfusion Blazor services. We do this in the main method in program.cs file. At this point, you can use Syncfusion DataGrid component on any of your Blazor application pages. Now, this is the same project that we've been working with throughout this video series. Notice, at the moment on this index.razor page, we are already using Syncfusion DataGrid component and it is being bound to this employees property, which obviously provides employee data. And this employees property is being initialized in this onInitialized async method. Notice here, we are calling our employee REST API service, retrieving data and using it to populate this employee's property. Take a look at this line on line number 37, task.delay. We introduced this line in our previous video to demonstrate Blazor Spinner component. Now, we don't want to wait 3 seconds every time we load this index razor page. So, in the interest of time, let's keep this line commented. Now, to enable paging, all we need to do is simply set this property allow paging to true. So, on the Syncfusion DataGrid component, set allow paging equals true. At the moment, in our employees database table, we only have 4 rows and we see those 4 rows as expected. Notice at the bottom of the grid, we have the pager, one of 1 pages with 4 items. Now, let's insert a few more rows into this employees table. And I have the SQL script ready for that. I'll have the script available on my blog and include the link to it in the description box below this video. Now, if you want to insert 20 rows, specify that number right here and execute the script. Let's actually insert 30 rows. So change the number to 30 and execute the script. Reload the web page. There we go. Take a look at the pager at the bottom. We now have 34 items. We are looking at 1 of 3 pages. On the first page, we have employee IDs from 1 to 12. On the second page, 13 to 24, and the rest on the third page. At the moment, you might be thinking, can I change the number of rows that are displayed on each page? Absolutely, we can. At the moment, by default, the data grid displays 12 rows. Let's change this to 5. And for that, all we need to do is set this page size property of grid page settings. So inside this data grid, just like grid columns, we include grid page settings. And on this, we set page size property to whatever number we want. In our case, we want to set it to 5. There we go, 5 rows on each page. We still have the same number of total rows, that is 34, but now they are distributed across 7 pages. At the moment, we have 7 pages in total, and all those 7 pages are displayed in the pager at the bottom here. Can we control how many number of pages are displayed here? Well, absolutely. For that, we use page count property. So just like page size on this grid page settings, we use page count. Another quick tip here. Notice from the IntelliSense, we can see the data type of this property. It is integer, which means we can set it to a number, the number of page that we want to display in the pager. Let's set it to 3, for example. There we go. Just the 3 pages as expected. And we also have these 3 dots. Upon clicking them, we see the next 3 pages. Upon clicking on the 3 dots again, we see the last 1 page. At the moment, we have hard-coded the page size to 5. This means on every page of the grid, 5 rows are displayed. What if another user wants to see 10 rows and another 15 rows? Every time we want to change the page size, we don't want to change our code. That's not a good idea. Instead, can we display a drop-down list with some values like 5, 10, 15, etc. And then the end user can pick the number of rows that they want to see on each page of the grid. Absolutely. And for that, as you might have already guessed, we set another property. And that property is page sizes, plural, and we set it to a value of true. There we go. We now have a drop-down list with different sizes. By default, 5 rows are displayed. Why? Well, that's because we have set the page size property to 5. But then the end user can pick and choose the number of rows they want to see. For example, if I select 10, we see 10 rows. If I select all, we see all the 34 rows. Now, in this drop-down list, we can see different sizes. Can we change these numbers? Absolutely. Now, instead of 5, 10, 12, and 20, let's display 5, 10, 15, and 20. For that, in our page, in the code block, let's include a string array. Let me use the prop code snippet for that. So the data type is string array, and let's call this property pager dropdown and initialize it to a new string array. And the values that we want are all, 5, 10, 15, and finally 20. All that is left to do is use this property as the value for page sizes property. Notice from the IntelliSense, this property data type is object, meaning we can set it to any value. For example, a Boolean value like true, or this string array property, which contains different page sizes. So let's specify this as the value now. So we use the symbol at and then our property name. Notice in the dropdown, we now see our custom sizes. Now, let's understand where paging is happening. Is it happening on the client side, in the browser, or on the server? Well, in our example, in this case, paging is happening on the client side. Let's actually prove this. Now, we want ASP.NET Core to log the SQL commands that are sent to the database. And for that, we need to include a setting in our application configuration file, appsettings.json. So within the logging section right here, we want to tell ASP.NET Core to log Microsoft Entity Framework Core database commands. So with this change in place, let's run our app again. On the web page, we see the data the same way as before. If we take a look at the output window in Visual Studio, by the way, if you don't see this output window, click on View and then Output. And then in the drop-down list right here, select our ASP.NET Core web server. And here we can see the SQL statement that is issued to the database. So let's copy this and execute it from SQL Server Management Studio. If we take a look at the Messages tab, notice all the 34 rows from the employees table are retrieved. Now, the point that I'm trying to prove is, though our web page is displaying only 5 rows, it's still retrieving all the rows from the database table. Now, let's see what's going to happen when we go to page 2. But before that, let's delete the log that we already have here. And for that, click this button, clear all, and then let's go to page 2. If we take a look at the web server log in Visual Studio, notice no additional queries are issued to the database. Now, let's go to page 3 and then maybe to page 6, and still no additional queries are issued to the database. So the point that I'm trying to prove is paging is happening on the client side in the browser. This is called client-side paging, and it works fine if the number of rows are less, maybe a few hundred or even 1,000. But if you have millions of rows, server-side paging, also called on-demand paging, provides better performance over client-side paging. We'll discuss implementing server-side paging in a later video. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.